when there is the desire, let's say there is this, when there is the desire, there is only the desire. When there is the desire, there is only the desire. It is inappropriate to say that I am having a desire. We do not have a desire. There is only the desire. Because to say I am having a desire would mean that the desire is something separate from me. In the moment of desire, there is nothing but the desire.
In that moment, there is nothing called I.
There is an I. There is a very strong I, which is desire. I am desire. I am desire. So what is to be done then? Here we are, and I am desire. Now? I am desire. Now? An I has been created, which is thoroughly enmeshed with desire, inseparable. So much so that I am desire. Now what? That mind that I am desire is just a desire. Please understand this. Desire does not have the nature of knowing. Desire just has the nature of what?
Desiring.
Satiation. Desiring. Desire is just desire. What is the nature of desire?
Just to crave for more.
Just desire. Desire as a word. To desire is the nature of desire. Please understand this. To know is not the nature of desire. When you are desire, then to know is not your nature. Then what will you not know? That I am desire. And hence the moment you know that I am desire, you are no more desire, because now you are knowing, and knowing is not the nature of
desire.
In the moment of knowing, you have already gone beyond desire. This is not suppression. This is not advocating to fulfill the desire to this extent or to that extent. This is just knowing that at this moment, I am nothing but a... Had you been only a desire, you could have not known that you are
desire.
And that is effectuality. When you are desirous, you just do not know what is happening. When you are desirous, you do not know what is happening. That is the nature of desire. To not to know and just... And just what?
Go for the desire.
Go for the desire. Ask for satiation. It does not know, remember. Knowing is your nature, not the nature of desire. Knowing is your nature, not the nature of desire. So it is sufficient just to know. What?
I am desire.
And that is the only way the who am I question is useful. Otherwise it is not useful. When you say I am desire, the question who am I has been answered wrongly, but usefully. Of course, you are not desire, that is not your nature. But in that moment, it is an appropriate and useful answer to say that I am desire. It's a useful reply. It will help. It will help because the moment the question comes, knowing has begun. Knowing has begun from desire nature. There has been a sudden change to self nature. From desire nature, there has been a quick, instantaneous change to self nature. It's enough. There is no need to ask, why am I angry? What can I do to control the anger? Because in the moment of anger, who are you?
Anger.
You are anger. and you do not exist as anything except anger. Are you a mother in that moment? Are you a civilized citizen in that moment? Are you the one who has accumulated loads of knowledge in that moment? Is that knowledge really active in that moment, in the moment of anger? What are you in the moment of anger? Just anger. Just anger. Just anger. And that is sufficient to know who am I? Anger. And that's, remember, this is not a correct answer. But this is a useful answer. When somebody like Raman says that go after who am I with all your mind, he does not mean that it has to be a succession of questions. All he means is that it has to be continuous, always. Because ultimately, if you are asking who am I persistently too many times, then you have anyway answered who am I. The asker of this question, what else are you doing? What else are you doing? Who am I does not go deep and deep and deep. Who am I is just a tool, it's not a question. Who am I has no answer. Just asking this is sufficient. Remember, the purpose of who am I is to just get rid of the illusion that I exist. Who am I has no other value. Who am I has no other value except a negative value. And what is the negative value? To see what I am not. Who am I will not tell you what you are. Who am I has a value only in telling you what you are. Otherwise, who am I has no value.
But then, who is the ask? What after that?
Just stop. So then who am I? The one having this itch. Finished. Mind is asking for a definite answer so that the definite answer can be incorporated within the mind, becomes a part of the known, and hence becomes a part of the ego. That's what the mind is trying to do. So who am I then? The hungry mind. Simple. Finished. Who am I? Hungry mind. Who am I is not a mystical question. Who am I will never lead you to any answer of any sort that you can ever imagine. Any answer that you will ever get will be highly misleading and will be ego driven. Whatever answer you will get, you will be able to put it in words and whatever, and all that is past.
So what is a variable for every second of life?
Yes, of course. Varies moment to moment, moment to moment. That's what the Buddha had to say. That it's a stream. It's a stream which appears to be one, but which in fact is.
What is exactly the difference when you said it is continuous but not succession?
Continuous in the sense that every moment you exist in time. The entity, who is the entity who is asking, who am I? The mind. And mind exists in
time.
So every moment, which means that the mind is continuously alert to its own delusion. And when you are alert to your delusion, that is freedom from delusion. Getting it? Mind is continuously alert that right now, what is the roop that I am donning? What is the mask that I am wearing? So who am I right now? A son. Who am I right now? An employee. Who is talking? Oh, it's the employee talking, so obviously. Who am I right now? A lustful man. Not me. Even to say not me is a little bit of imprudence. Because you have assumed that there exists a me apart from what you really are right now. Don't even say not me.
Will it be the case that when I say that who am I, I am a lustful person, the lust will disappear?
Don't ask that. See whether that happens.
And if I am lustful, then let me be called as lustful. Address yourself not as Nishit, but as, you know, Lusty Singh in that moment. And that will be sufficient. If it is honest enough, it will be sufficient. Again, this is not a prescription for quelling of desires. I am a lustful man and you can still go ahead and satisfy your lust. I am desirous of this jalebi. I know who am I right now. Who am I? I am a hormone driven, enzyme driven, biological organism craving for a particular food. It's all right. I may still go ahead and... Why ask that? So the moment you say, will it not increase? Who am I? An insecure person who wants to know what will happen after that. Because only security asks for what will happen then. When students ask me that who am I, sometimes I'm irritated. Because that fellow very well knows who he is. So, what do I do sometimes? What's your name? Rohit. Rohit, come here and sit. So you already know you are Rohit, you are responding to that name. Then why are you asking? When we are so full of the answer, it's better to stick to the answer that we already have. Just stick to that. And that is what who am I is all about. The honest answer. Give an honest answer. That is all that who am I asks of you. It does not ask for a metaphysical, mystical, learned answer. All it demands is honesty. Right now you are afraid. Say, who am I? A man afraid. Right now you are distracted. Say, confess, at least to yourself. Who am I? A man distracted. And that is sufficient. Not only that is sufficient. Not only is that sufficient. You cannot go beyond that. Any step beyond that would be a dishonest step. And would only delude you further. So just stick to what is. It's actually very simple. Mm-hmm. Who am I is not serious affair. Nothing is serious affair, yeah, in that sense. All of these are very, very simple techniques that would anyway come to a simple and innocent mind. Because we are a little... So, we have to use them as established techniques. Otherwise, a simply honest man would anyway know what he is doing. He does not even need to ask, who am I? And it would be a great misinterpretation to think that who am I, koham, is intended at taking you to the answer aham brahmasmi. It is not. Who am I inquiry is not at all intended to take you to a definite answer. Not at all. Anybody who says that does not understand the mind. He simply does not understand the mind. It is not intended to bring to your answer. In fact, one of the questions that was there in the paper that you were just setting, that the question who am I can be answered only in the
negative.
In the denial mode. You can only deny. Deny in the sense, know what I am and know that, oh my God, this is changeable. Right now I was a listener. Next moment I am something else and something else. That is the only denial. Otherwise, who am I is niti niti. Nothing beyond that. And there is no point taking who am I and then digging deep into it as if something would come up. Nothing would come up. All that is there is the mind, and the mind is always instantaneous. What is the point in digging? Till you dig, what has come? The next moment. And the answer has changed. So what are you digging for? So what is the point in digging? You are digging thinking that there is one thing that I'll reach up to. Whereas the moment you pick up your spade and try to dig, the answer has already changed.
You are a digger.
So it's not about just sitting and meditating, who am I? It has to be a continuous presence, knowing what I am doing. That's what who am I is.
Contextual.
Hmm?
Contextual.
Mind is always in context. Exactly. When you say context, what you mean is relative to something.
Mm-hmm.
Mind is always in relation to something. Mind is always in relation to something. You will never get an answer of who am I that is independent of anything else. Who am I answer would always have a relationship.
But even when we say I'm not this, that is also a statement and affirmative.
It's a statement and affirmative, but I would want to say that it is a bit of an insouciant answer. You are daring to step into what is not your territory. You are daring to step into what is not your territory. When you say, for example, I am not the desire. I am not the desire. You are already stepping into danger area. Though it is all right. Because it is not a strictly positive answer. Because you have not positively said something. You are just saying, I am not the desire. But even that is dangerous. Stay with this, that I am desire. Stay with this. Because you know, the moment you say, I am not the desire, the ego finds a resting place, a refuge. Ego says, fine, this desire is just fleeting, temporary. It has come. Let it do its work. It will go away. After all, I am not the desire. I am some sacred, pristine, stainless thing. I am not the desire. You know, I am not doing all this. I am the Atman. This desire, this all this rubbish, you know. They come and go like things on the screen of a movie hall and all that rubbish that we read. So the ego very conveniently gets a spiritual refuge. You know, the ego is now hiding in a temple. So don't even say that I am not the desire. Be honest enough to just say, I am desire. Stay with that. Very honestly. Just as you had that fellow yahan pe likha hai, tattoo, mera baap chor hai. That honestly. You're looking at it. Yes. I am desire. I am a thief. Who am I? A thief. And that is sufficient.
It also gives the mind an equilibrium.
It gives the mind a mirror.
A bearing.
Now the mind cannot be deluded. Now you cannot have an illusion about yourself. And that is sufficient. Even the Atman is a big illusion. Because where does the concept of Atman live? In the mind. And when the mind says, I am not this, not that, this and that. Yesterday you were reading Rumi, I am sure I have come from somewhere else and I intend to go back there. All these are wonderful illusions. Wonderful illusions. Heaven and hell. And my sacred nature, my Buddha nature. Even the worst criminal has a Buddha nature. Do you really know that? Know the criminal to be a criminal and that's sufficient. Incidentally, this itself is Buddha nature. This knowing is Buddha nature. Claiming is not Buddha nature. Claiming that I have a Buddha nature will not give you a Buddha nature. Knowing that I am a rotten thief is Buddha nature. Do you understand the difference? One is, I am indulging in all kinds of rubbish. But at the same time, what am I claiming?
I am the
pristine soul. Beyond time, beyond this and that. Untouched, uncorrupted. Nirakar. Nirvikar. The other thing is, directly knowing. I am an idiot. And that is sufficient. When you know you are an idiot, that itself is the Buddha nature. And this is not a technique as such. This is just knowing. The best technique is actually a non-technique. You see this? And the most complicated technique would only become a tool of the ego. The best technique would always be so simple that you will be astonished. Just as he says, na? You'll hit your hand upon your thigh and say, ah, so simple. The best techniques are always non-techniques, extremely simple. So simple that they can be assimilated. They resonate your nature.